Hello everyone, in this video we are going to discuss about sphenoid. Now sphenoid is an unpaired bone which is found in the floor or base of the skull, and that is lodging air sinuses, and so as it is also classified under the heading of pneumatic bone. It is irregular in outline and it is having a body in the center and a pair of lesser wings and greater wings on either side. Anteroinferiorly it is having pterygoid processes. So by and large, it looks like a bat with a body and expanded wings all around, and this pterygoid processes represent its legs. So this is the outline of sphenoid. Now when you compare it with articulated skull, you can make out this is a superior view of the sphenoid, and this is how it looks like. This is the body, and over here will be greater wings. These are the lesser wings, and from below you can make out the pterygoid processes. Now in front it is related with orbital plate of frontal bone and ethmoid, and behind it is related with the petrous part of the temporal bone on either side, and over here it is related with the squamous part. Above there are parietal bones. So this is how all around it is related with the other skull bones. Now let's see individual parts of the sphenoid. As I mentioned, it has got a body in the center, and there are two lesser wings on either side below, and on side there are two greater wings. Obviously according to the sizes of the wings the names are given, and anteroinferiorly there are two pterygoid processes. Now when you see the body looks like a cube, or it is cuboidal in shape, and it is having six surfaces, namely superior, anterior, inferior, posterior and two lateral surfaces. Now the superior surface, anteriormost part of it, it is showing an ethmoidal spine. Now this portion is related to the posterior aspect of the ethmoid. Let me show you ethmoid. So this is the ethmoid, and this is its superior surface, and this is crista galli. This is cribriform plate of the ethmoid, and over here the posterior part of cribriform plate and the anteriormost part of body of sphenoid, its superior surface, the ethmoidal, they are lying like this. So this is how it is oriented. Now let's see how it looks like in an articulated skull. So here you can clearly make out this is the superior surface, and its anteriormost part is the ethmoidal spine, and that is related in front with this cribriform plate of ethmoid. This is a superior view of the ethmoid. So this is the ethmoidal spine. Next to it is the jugum sphenoidale. Let's see in separate one. See over here, this portion is termed as jugum sphenoidale, and that forms part of the floor of anterior cranial fossa along with the superior surface of the lesser wing. Okay, see over here the same thing. This is jugum sphenoidale, and along with the superior surface of lesser wing, along with the orbital plate of frontal bone, these bones together are contributing in formation of the anterior cranial fossa. Now behind to the jugum sphenoidale there is a sulcus, and this sulcus is termed as sulcus chiasmaticus. See this. Now on other side of it, it leads to the optic canal. Now above and behind to this sulcus chiasmaticus over here, it is related to anteriormost part of optic chiasma. Now still behind, along the posterior margin of sulcus chiasmaticus, there is an elevated area. Now this is termed as tuberculum cella. Let me bring it closer. See, this is termed as tuberculum cella, and on either side of this tuberculum cella there are two bony elevations, and these are termed as middle clinoid processes. Now this middle clinoid processes are connected to the anterior clinoid processes, which are part and parcel of lesser wing of sphenoid. See, these bony elevations are termed as anterior clinoid processes. Now the middle and anterior clinoid processes are connected by carotidoclinoid ligament. Now throughout the course of this tuberculum cella, it will provide attachment to anterior margin of diaphragma cella, which is bridging over here in this gap, and within this gap there is pituitary gland. Okay, so behind This tuberculum cella there is a depressed area, and this is termed as hypophyseal fossa or pituitary fossa, which it is lodging pituitary gland, and that is roofed by the diaphragma cella, which is a dural shelf that runs from tuberculum cella in front to the dorsum cella behind. So posterior border of diaphragma cella is attached over here. So this is a quadrilateral bony plate. This is termed as dorsum cella. And as we have discussed, it will receive attachment, posterior attachment of diaphragma cella. Now on other side of it, this dorsum cella shows two tubercles. These are termed as posterior clinoid processes. Now these posterior clinoid processes are connected to the anterior clinoid processes via a ligament like this. And this is termed as interclinoid ligament. Now below and lateral to the posterior clinoid process, it shows a bony spine. This is termed as petrosal spine. See this. Now this is connected to tip of petrous temporal bone by petrospinoidal ligament. Let me show you separate temporal bone. Say this is temporal bone, left temporal bone, and this is petrous part of the temporal bone. This is tip of the petrous temporal bone. Now if we join these two together like this, so the tip of petrous temporal is connected to this petrosal spine, and together they are providing attachment to petrospinoidal ligament. Now below to this ligament, the abducens nerve crosses this area, pierces dura, and it enters into the cavernous sinus, which is situated somewhere over here. Now the superior border of this petrous temporal bone and this posterior clinoid process. Okay, this is the area which is providing attachment to attached margin of tentorium cerebelli. Obviously, the attachment goes behind into the transversal sulci. Let me show you an articulated skull. So this is dorsum cella, and over here will be the posterior clinoid process, and there is a continuous attachment of the attached margin of tentorium cerebelli. Like this, this is transverse sulcus, this is internal occipital protuberance. So this is how entirely the tentorium cerebelli, its attached margin is oriented. Now posterior aspect of dorsum cella forms a continuous slopy surface which is directed downward and backward, and it is connected with superior surface of basio occiput. So this is occipital bone, this is basio occiput, this is its superior surface. And these two together are connected like this, and they are forming a continuous slopy surface which is termed as clivus. So over here it is related with pons, medulla oblongata, basilar artery, its branches. Okay, so this is the clivus. So this is regarding superior surface. Now let's see posterior surface. Now this posterior surface is connected to the anterior surface of the basio occiput via a hyaline cartilage. There is a plate of hyaline cartilage which is joining these two, and they are connected by primary cartilaginous joint, and which will contribute to increase anteroposterior length of the skull up to the age of 25. So initially there is a synchondrosis type of the joint which gets fused after 25 years, and that is then termed as synostosis. So the fusion will take place after 25 years. So this is regarding posterior surface. Now let's see inferior surface. So this is the territory of inferior surface. See this, and it shows three features. In the midline there is a bony ridge, and this is termed as sphenoidal rostrum. And this sphenoidal rostrum is connected to upper grooved margin of the womer. So this is the separate womer. These two are ala, and in the center is the groove portion. So this portion is connected to the sphenoidal rostrum like this. Okay, these two are connected by syndicalis type of the fibrous joint. Now let me show you the same in articulated skull. See over here, this is the humor, these are ala, and over here this is the inferior aspect of the sphenoid. So over here will be the sphenoidal rostrum, and those two are connected by fibrous joint. So you can correlate the same over here like this. See this. This is how they are connected. Now on either side of sphenoidal rostrum, there are part of sphenoidal concha. Now when you see it from below and in front, these two are the sphenoidal concha, which are looking like a triangular bony plate. Now the sphenoidal concha has got upper vertical part and lower horizontal part. So this lower horizontal part is seen in the inferior surface on either side of the sphenoidal rostrum. This is sphenoidal rostrum, and these two are the lower horizontal part of sphenoidal concha. Now this sphenoidal concha, obviously they are lying on either side of the sphenoidal rostrum, so these two are related to the upper surface of the ala of Wurmer. So similarly, when we connect it again, you can clearly make out that these are the ala of Wurmer will be connected to the lower horizontal part of sphenoidal concha like this. Okay, now third feature of inferior surface is the vaginal processes of medial pterygoid plate. Now these two are pterygoid processes, and they are giving rise to two bony plates, medial and lateral pterygoid plates. Now this medial pterygoid plate, along its medial aspect, it shows a shelf like bony projection which is hanging from the medial aspect of the medial pterygoid plate, and it is related to the inferior aspect of body of sphenoid. These are the vaginal processes. See this vaginal process of medial pterygoid plate. Now this vaginal process is connected to two bones. In its upper part, it is connected to the ala of Wurmer, and together they form a canal which is termed as vomerovaginal canal. So over here, these sphenoidal concha are related to the ala of Wurmer, and this ala of Wurmer and this vaginal process will overlap with each other. So superior surface of this vaginal process is related to the lateral aspect of the ala of Wurmer, and they form a canal over here. This is termed as vomerovaginal canal. No significant structure passed through it. And inferior aspect of this vaginal process is related to the sphenoidal process of palatine bone, and together they form palatino-vaginal canal, which will allow passage of pharyngeal vessel and now. Now there is a separate video of this palatino-vaginal canal, and that you can see. But right now let me show you how these two are connected with each other. So over here, this is another sphenoid bone I have, and let me show you how this palatino-vaginal canal is formed. So this is its inferior surface. This is again sphenoidal rostrum, and these are the medial pterygoid plates. Over here you can see these two are vaginal processes. Okay, now anterior and inferior part of this vaginal process is related to sphenoidal process of palatine bone, as we have discussed. So this is the maxilla with articulated palatine bone, and this is the horizontal plate, this is perpendicular plate of palatine bone, this is the sphenoidal process. Now this sphenoidal process will come in contact with anterior and inferior part of this vaginal process. Now let's just connect these two together. So this is pyramidal process of palatine bone, and that will fix between the gap of medial and lateral pterygoid plate. This is termed as pterygoid fissure. So here these two will get lost, and we'll have to focus on this sphenoidal process and this vaginal process. See this, when I join these two together, see over here there will be formation of a canal, and that is between palatine bone and the vaginal process. So as the name given to it is palatino-vaginal canal. See over here, there is a small canal. You can see this is sphenoidal process, and over here this is the bony projection, vaginal process. So over here you can see a small aperture, and this is palatino-vaginal canal. As we have discussed, it will allow passage of pharyngeal vessel and pharyngeal nerve. So this is regarding inferior surface. Now let's see anterior surface. So similar like inferior surface, it has got three features. In the midline there is a bony projection. This is called a sphenoidal crest. On either side of it, you can see upper vertical part of sphenoidal concha, and laterally there is a rough area which is broken over here. So these three bony features are observed. Now in the center, as I mentioned, it is having a sphenoidal crest. Now this sphenoidal crest will come in contact with posterior aspect of perpendicular plate of the ethmoid, and together they form part of bony nasal septum. Let me connect these two together. See over here, this is ethmoid and these two are labyrinth, and in the center you can see a thin perpendicular plate. Okay, now it's posterior part. This is anterior part, this is posterior part. So over here, this portion is connected to this sphenoidal crest like this. If we join these two together, see, this is how the articulation will take place, and together they form part of bony nasal septum. Okay, the perpendicular plate is a bit broken posteriorly, but you can clearly make out that this is how they get connected like this. Now, as I mentioned, laterally it is having a rough articular area. So obviously in the center there is attachment of perpendicular plate of ethmoid. So on either side obviously there will be attachment of this ethmoidal labyrinth. Okay, so again you can clearly make out these two labyrinths, their posterior aspect is in connection with the lateral rough area on the anterior surface like this. Okay, so in the center there is perpendicular plate, on either side there are the labyrinths. So here we have got sphenoidal crest, and on either side the rough articular area. Now talking about sphenoidal concha, these two are triangular bony plates found on either side of the sphenoidal crest. So this is upper vertical part of sphenoidal concha, and that is continuous below with lower horizontal part. So this, you can see the outline of sphenoidal concha. So on either side of sphenoidal crest there are two sphenoidal concha, its vertical part, and along their medial aspect over here there are sphenoidal foramen, which is a bit broken over here, but you can clearly make out the margin, and this is termed as sphenoidal foramen. Now deep inside you can see sphenoidal sinuses on either side. So obviously these sinuses are opening over here in the sphenoidal foramen, and exactly at this place these sphenoidal foramen are opening into sphenoethmoidal recess, which is situated in the superior meatus of lateral wall of nose. So this is regarding anterior surface. Now let's see lateral surfaces, which are found on either side of the body. Now these lateral surfaces posteriorly and above, they are connected to the greater wings. You can see over here these two are greater wings, and this is the lateral surface. So here these greater wings are attached to it, and anteroinferiorly these lateral surfaces are connected to these two pterygoid processes. These two are pterygoid processes. Okay, now you know on either side of the body there are two cavernous sinuses. So this is the territory of cavernous sinuses, and you know there are certain contents. One of the important content of cavernous sinus is internal carotid artery, which is related to the medial wall of cavernous sinus. Obviously this portion, lateral surface, is related to the internal carotid artery, and which is basically indenting the lateral surface, and it forms a sulcus, and that is termed as carotid sulcus. You can see over here, because of indentation of the internal carotid artery, the shape of the sulcus is italic alphabet F, and that extends from the posterior aspect of cavernous sinus. Over here the internal carotid artery enters into the cavernous sinus, which is basically coming from the carotid canal of petrous part of the temporal bone, and then it enters into the cavernous sinus. So the petrous part of the carotid internal carotid artery will then convert into cavernous part of the internal carotid artery. Now you can see this sulcus is going upward, and over here this is anterior clinoid process, which is part and parcel of laser wing. And over here this is tuberculum cella. So this is the middle clinoid process, and as we have discussed, these two are connected by a ligament that is termed as carotidoclinoid ligament. So obviously this internal carotid artery will pass through this foramen. So upturned end of internal carotid artery will come out of this foramen. So this is regarding body. Now let's see greater wings. These are two triangular bony plates which are curved upward. They are very stout and they are attached to the lateral surface of body. See this, these are the greater wings. Now each greater wing is having three surfaces, namely superior or cerebral, lateral, and third is orbital surface. Each greater wing is having two borders, namely squamosal border and posterior. See this? This is squamosal border. This is posterior. Each greater wing is having a spine of sphenoid, which is situated at the junction of posterior border and squamosal border. See over here, this is a bony spicule, this is spine of sphenoid. Plus, each greater wing is having a tip. Say this is a tip. And there is a rough triangular area medial to the tip. Say this. So these many parts are there for each greater wing. Now let's see first the surfaces. So as I mentioned, it has got three surfaces. First is the superior surface or cerebral surface, and along with the petrous temporal bone, it forms part of middle cranial fossa. Say this over here, you can see. So here is the cerebral surface or superior surface of the greater wing, and this is petrous temporal bone. So this is the territory of middle cranial fossa. Now this lodges temporal lobe, and along its medial aspect you can see certain foramina. So mainly there are three foramina found along the medial aspect of each greater wing from before backward. The first is the foramen rotundum. See this, the margins are circular and so is the name given to it. Now this will communicate middle cranial fossa behind to the pterygobelidine fossa in front. So this is the territory of pterygobelidine fossa, and over here this foramen rotundum opens. Now it carries maxillary nerve into it. Postrolateral to the foramen rotundum, there is an oval shaped foramen, and so as the name given to it is foramen oval. Now it allows passage of four structures, and there is a mnemonic to remember the structures passing through foramen oval is MALE. M stands for mandibular nerve, A stands for accessory meningeal artery, L stands for lesser petrosal nerve, and E stands for emissary vein. Now, when you see it from below, and again in articulated skull, you can clearly make out that this foramen oval communicates middle cranial fossa to the infratemporal fossa. So here is the territory of infratemporal fossa, and this foramen oval will communicate middle cranial fossa to it. Now, postrolateral to this foramen oval, over here you can see there is another foramen, and margins are having multiple spines, and so as the name given to it is foramen spinosum. Okay, there is again a mnemonic to remember the contents passing through it, and that is triple M. So first M belongs to the middle meningeal artery, second M belongs to the middle meningeal vein, and third M belongs to the meningeal branch of mandibular nerve, that is also termed as nervous spinosus. So by and large, these three structures, which are named with alphabet M, they are passing through this foramen spinosum. So three main consistent foramina are found along the medial aspect of each greater wing. Now sometimes there are two additional foramina found. So less commonly, you may find a foramen which is situated between foramen oval and foramen spinosum, and that is termed as canaliculus innominatus, and that will allow passage of lesser petrosal nerve. So whenever this canaliculus innominatus is present, the lesser petrosal nerve, which is generally passing through foramen oval, will then pass through this canaliculus. And second and inconsistent foramen is foramen of Visalius or emissary sphenoidal foramen. And whenever it is present, it is generally found along the medial side of this foramen oval, somewhere over here. And this will allow passage of emissary vein, and that will communicate the cavernous sinus inside the skull with the pterygoid venous plexus over here, which is situated in infratemporal fossa around the lateral pterygoid muscle. So three consistent and two inconsistent foramina are found along the medial aspect of the greater wing. So this is regarding cerebral surface or superior surface. Now next is the lateral surface. So obviously it is found along the lateral aspect of greater wing, and there is a bony crest situated in between, and that is termed as infratemporal crest of greater wing, and that will divide the lateral surface into upper and lower part. The upper part will form floor of the temporal fossa and it will provide origin to temporalis muscle, whereas the crest plus the lower part will form roof of the infratemporal fossa, and together these two will provide origin to the head of lateral derivoid muscle. Let me show you the same inarticulated skull. So here when you see the skull from lateral aspect in normal lateralis, what you will find is the lateral surface of the greater wing, and this is the upper part. Now over here, you know, this is the temporal fossa and obviously it will provide origin to the temporalis muscle. Deep to it, below to it, and you see it from below, this is the infratemporal crest, and below to it over here, this portion provides origin to lateral derivoid muscle, its upper head. So this is the territory of infratemporal fossa, this is the territory of temporal fossa. So this is regarding lateral surface. Now third surface is orbital surface. See this, it is quadrilateral bony plate with four borders, and the surface itself is forming major portion of the lateral wall of bony orbit. Let's see inarticulated skull. So here this is bony orbit and this is its lateral wall. Now major portion of it, this portion is contributed by this orbital surface of greater wing of sphenoid. See this, you can see the sutural lines. So here you can see this is the orbital surface. Now as I mentioned, it is quadrilateral, so it is having four borders. Now the upper and lateral borders or upper and lateral margins are articular. See this. Now above it articulates with frontal bone, and laterally over here it articulates with zygomatic bone. Let me show you. So this is the frontal bone, this is squamous part, this is orbital plate, and this orbital plate will get connected with the upper margin of orbital surface like this. See this. Okay, this is how these two are connected. Now this lateral margin will get connected with zygomatic bone. Let me show you. Say this is left zygomatic bone, and over here along the lateral margin the articulation will take place like this. See this. So above there is attachment of orbital plate of frontal bone, laterally there is attachment of zygomatic bone. The same thing you can appreciate in articulated skull. So over here you can see this is the zygomatic bone, and over here you can see the suture between these two, whereas from above comes the orbital plate of frontal bone and you can see the line of suture. So this is upper margin, this is lateral margin of orbital surface. Now the medial margin and inferior margin, they are non-articular. Now obviously over here you can see along the upper margin, along with the lesser wing of sphenoid and body of sphenoid, there is formation of supraorbital fissure. So this medial margin will help in formation of supraorbital fissure, whereas the inferior margin, which is again non-articular, along with the maxilla and part of zygomatic bone, it will contribute to form inferior orbital fissure. See this. Now the supraorbital fissure will communicate orbit with this middle cranial fossa, whereas the inferior orbital fissure will communicate orbit with the infratemporal fossa. Now along the medial margin, somewhere along its midway, you can see a tubercle. See over here. Now this tubercle will provide attachment to tendinous ring of Zinn, and that will run across the supraorbital fissure. And over here, this is optic canal, which is formed by splitting of lesser wing of sphenoid. So along its upper and medial margin, there is attachment of tendinous ring. So lateral it is attached to this tubercle, medial it is attached in relation to superior and medial margin of optic canal, and that will by and large divide the entire supraorbital fissure into medial, intermediate and lateral compartments, and there are structures passing through each compartments. So same thing is shown here in this diagram. This is the left superior orbital fissure, and you can see this is the greater wing of sphenoid, this is lesser wing of sphenoid, this will be the body, this is retort shaped fissure, and over here this is the tubercle what we are talking about, and that is providing attachment to tendinous ring of Zinn, and which is above attached to the superior and medial margin of the optic canal. So this will enclose optic canal, which will allow passage of optic nerve, ophthalmic artery and three meninges. Now as we have discussed, this tendinous ring of Zinn will divide the superior orbital fissure into lateral, intermediate and medial compartment. Now this lateral compartment will allow passage of recurrent meningeal branch of lacrimal artery plus three nerves, LFT, that is a mnemonic you can remember. So L stands for lacrimal, F for frontal nerve. These two are branches of ophthalmic division of trigeminal nerve, whereas this T stands for trochlear nerve. Additionally, it will also allow passage of superior ophthalmic vein. Now in the intermediate compartment, mainly the four nerves are passing, upper and lower division of oculomotor nerve, and in between these two there lies nasociliary nerve and abducens nerve. Now nasociliary is again a branch of ophthalmic division of trigeminal nerve. So mainly three branches are given from ophthalmic division of trigeminal nerve: lacrimal, frontal and nasociliary. Now the medialmost compartment will allow passage of inferior ophthalmic vein. This tendinous ring of Zinn itself will provide attachment to four recti: superior, inferior, medial and lateral. So this is how this superior orbital fissure is oriented. So that is regarding orbital surface. Now let's see border. As I mentioned, it has got two borders. One is squamosal border and another is posterior border. Now the squamosal border will articulate with anteroinferior margin of squamous temporal bone. Now let me show you temporal bone. See, this is temporal bone, this is squamous temporal, and this is its anteroinferior margin. So over here, this is how the articulation will take place, like this. Okay, and that you can correlate with articulated skull. Same thing you can appreciate. This is the squamosal border and this is squamous part of the temporal bone. So here is the articulation. See this. Now next is the posterior border. Over here you can see this is a posterior border. Now medially it is non-articular, laterally it is articular. So medially this non-articular area forms anterior boundary of foramen and lacerum. Let me show you the same in articulated skull. So over here you can see this is foramen and lacerum, this is posterior border and this is medial non-articulated part. So this is the anterior margin of foramen and lacerum, which is formed by posterior border, and in its anterior wall, in its anterior margin, there opens pterygoid canal. So same thing you can appreciate over here. See this. This is posterior border and along its anterior margin you can see this is pterygoid canal. Now this will allow passage of nerve to pterygoid canal or Vidian's nerve, and it is formed by contribution of greater petrosal nerve and deep petrosal nerve. So greater petrosal nerve belongs to the parasympathetic component and deep petrosal nerve belongs to the sympathetic component. Together they form nerve to pterygoid canal, and in front it opens into the pterygopalate and fossa. For detailed description you can watch my separate video on boundaries of pterygopalate and fossa. So here this is the territory of it. Now posteriorly, this foramen lacerum is bounded by tip of the petrous part of the temporal bone. So again, this is temporal bone and this is the petrous part, this is its tip. So when we join these two together like this, you can now appreciate formation of foramen lacerum. See this, this is the foramen lacerum. So as I mentioned, posteriorly it is contributed by tip of the petrous temporal bone, and when you see it from in front, will appreciate opening of carotid canal. So the tip will allow passage of carotid canal, which starts from the undersurface, and obviously it is allowing passage of internal carotid artery with sympathetic plexus around it. So internal carotid artery will come out of this carotid canal and will temporarily seen in the upper part of foramen lacerum over here, and then it enters into the cavernous sinus lodging in the carotid sulcus. So that is what we already discussed. So this is medial non-articular part of posterior border. Now lateral portion is articular, and this portion will get articulated with petrous part of the temporal bone. So again the same thing, we'll have to connect these two bones together, and see, this is how the articulation will take place. And when you see it from below, you can appreciate the articulation over here. Now this portion is forming a sulcus, and this is termed as sulcus tubae. Now this will lodge cartilaginous part of auditory tube. So this is regarding posterior border. Now next is the tip. So this is a tip Now it will come in contact with frontal bone, parietal bone and squamous part of the temporal bone, specifically anteroinferior angle of the parietal bone. Let me show you the same in articulated skull. So over here you can clearly appreciate this is the greater wing of sphenoid, this is its tip, and this is frontal bone, this is the parietal bone, its anteroinferior angle, this is squamous part of the temporal bone. So these four bones are collectively joined at this portion by an H-shaped suture. Now this point of articulation is termed as sterion. Now medial to the tip there is a rough triangular area, and this portion is connected with the frontal bone. Let me show you the same over here. You can see this is the corresponding rough triangular area, and these two together will articulate like this. See, this is how the articulation will take place. So this is orbital plate of frontal bone, this is squamous part of the frontal bone, and this is the rough triangular area over here belonging to the sphenoid, just medial to the tip. Now last bony feature of greater wing is spinosphenoid. See, this is a bony spicule situated at the junction of posterior border and squamosal border. See over here. Now this is providing attachment to two muscles and three ligaments. The muscles are tensor tympani and tensor velar palatini, whereas the ligaments are sphenomandibular ligament, anterior ligament of malleus and pterygospinous ligament. Now this is a lateral pterygoid plate, this is its anterior border, this is posterior border, and along the posterior border there is a tubercle. Now this tubercle is connected to the spinosphenoid via this pterygospinous ligament. The second is sphenomandibular ligament, which is connected below to the lingula of mandible. Now this is mandible, this is ramus, and this is mandibular foramen, which is guarded by tongue-like protrusion. This is lingula. Now this is connected with the sphenomandibular ligament. And third is anterior ligament of malleus, which is going behind in the middle ear, and that is connected to the malleus via medial part of pterotympanic fissure. For detailed description, you can see my separate video on temporal bone. So these three ligaments, namely pterygospinous ligament, sphenomandibular ligament and anterior ligament of malleus, are connected to it, and there are two muscles, tensor tympani and tensor velar palatini. Additionally, medial aspect of the spinosphenoid is related to cartilaginous part of auditory tube and chorda tympani nerve, whereas laterally it is related to auriculotemporal nerve. So this is regarding spinosphenoid. Now next are the lesser wings. These are triangular bony plates which are attached to the anterior and superior part of lateral surface of body. See over here. Now individual lesser wing will split to enclose optic canal by two roots, anterior and posterior roots. Now this optic canal will allow passage of optic nerve, ophthalmic artery and three meninges. That is what we already discussed. Now individual lesser wing is having anterior and posterior borders and two surfaces, superior and inferior. Now this anterior border will articulate with posterior border of orbital plate of frontal bone. So this is squamous part, this is orbital plate of frontal bone, and over here this anterior border will articulate like this. Okay, now similar thing you can appreciate in articulated skull. Let me show you. So over here you can see these are the lesser wings, and this is the orbital plate of frontal bone. Now over here you can see the joint or junction between these two. Now posterior border is sharp, it is free, and that is forming boundary of floor of anterior and middle cranial fossa. Now this sharp border is lodged in the stem of little sulcus of cerebral hemisphere, and below it is related to sphenoparietal sinus, that is one of the dural venous sinus. Now when we trace this sharp posterior border, it forms a bony projection, and this is termed as anterior clinoid process. Now this anterior clinoid process is attached to carotidoclinoid ligament, that is already we have discussed, that is a ligament joining anterior and middle clinoid processes. Second is interclinoid ligament, that is a ligament connecting anterior clinoid process with the posterior clinoid process. And third is the anterior free margin of tentorium cerebelli, that is a third structure attached to the anterior clinoid process. Let me show you the same in diagram. See over here, you can see this is tentorium cerebelli, and this is attached margin which is attached to the posterior clinoid process, and this is U-shaped free margin which is attached over here to the anterior cleanal process. Now, superior surface is smooth along with the orbital plate. It will form floor of anterior cranial fossa, and over here it is related to the orbital surface of frontal lobe. Now, next is the undersurface, which you can see from in front, and over here you can see this is the undersurface of the lacer wing, which is forming posteriormost part of roof of bony orbit. Regarding boundaries of bony orbit, you can see my separate video. Now, as we have discussed, this lacer wing will split to form optic canals. Obviously, it will be in the roof of bony orbit. And in diagram of superior orbital fissure, we already discussed that the tubercle over here along the orbital surface of greater wing and superior and medial margin of this optic canal will provide attachment to tendinous ring of Zinn. Now, apart from providing attachment to tendinous ring of Zinn, the inferior surface of lacer wing over here will provide attachment to levator palpebrae superioris, and medially over here it will provide attachment to superior oblique muscle of eyeball. So that is about lacer wing. Now, next is the pterygoid process. Now, these are two thick bony bars situated at the junction of greater wing with this lateral surface. Over here you can see these are the pterygoid processes. Now, below these pterygoid processes will split to form medial and lateral pterygoid plates. So this is medial pterygoid plate, this is lateral pterygoid plate. Now, posteriorly these pterygoid plates are separated by pterygoid fossa. Okay, this is pterygoid fossa, whereas anteriorly in upper part they are fused, in lower part they are separated, and this is termed as pterygoid fissure. Now, this will articulate with pyramidal process of palatine bone. Let me show you. So these are the palatine bones, and over here you can see this is horizontal plate, this is perpendicular plate, and at the junction behind is the pyramidal process. That is what we are discussing, and this will get lodged into the pterygoid fissure. Over here you can see this is how these two are connected, like this, and posteriorly this pyramidal process will fill the gap of this pterygoid fossa. Let me show you in another sphenoid and palatine bone. So this is another sphenoid I have, and this is maxilla with attached palatine bone. So this is perpendicular plate, this is the horizontal plate, and over here this is the pyramidal process. Now, over here this is the pterygoid fissure, and it will be lodged by this pyramidal process. So this is how they get joined, and posteriorly, as we have discussed, this pyramidal process will fill the gap of this pterygoid fossa. So this is how the articulation will take place. Now, in the upper border, as we have discussed, these two plates are fused, and over here this is forming posterior boundary of pterygopalatine fossa. Now, regarding pterygoid plates, first is the lateral pterygoid plate, which is quadrilateral, and it is deviated laterally. It is having two surfaces, lateral and medial, plus it is having two borders, anterior and posterior. The anterior border is free, and that is forming posterior boundary of pterygomaxillary fissure. Let me show you an articulated skull. So over here you can see this is the lateral pterygoid plate, and this is the pterygomaxillary fissure. Now, this pterygomaxillary fissure communicates infratemporal fossa with the pterygopalatine fossa. Say this, it is a fissure between anterior border of lateral pterygoid plate behind and in front by this maxilla. See this. Now, this posterior border, it is again free, and midway it is showing a bony process, and that will articulate with spinosphenoid via pterygospinous ligament. The same thing we already discussed in spinosphenoid, but let me show you it again. So this is the posterior border of the lateral pterygoid plate, and over here this is the bony process which will articulate with the spinosphenoid via pterygospinous ligament. Now, this lateral surface, it is forming medial boundary of infratemporal fossa. So this is the territory of infratemporal fossa, and over here you can see this lateral surface of lateral pterygoid plate will form medial boundary of infratemporal fossa. Now, regarding detailed description of boundaries of infratemporal fossa, you can see my separate video. Apart from that, it will also provide principal attachment of lower head of lateral pterygoid muscle, whereas this medial surface of lateral pterygoid plate will provide principal attachment of medial pterygoid muscle. So you can say that on either side of the lateral pterygoid plate there is attachment of lateral pterygoid and medial pterygoid muscle. Now next is medial pterygoid plate. Like lateral pterygoid plate, it has got two borders, anterior and posterior, plus two surfaces, medial and lateral. This anterior border will articulate with perpendicular plate of palatine bone along its posterior border. So over here, this is right palatine bone I have, and this is its horizontal plate, this is perpendicular plate, and this is its posterior border. So these two will articulate like this. Regarding detailed description, you can see my separate video on palatine bone. Now posterior border, it is relatively free, and near its lower end it shows a hook like bony spicule. Now this is termed as pterygoid hambulus. See this. Now this pterygoid hambulus will behave as a pulley, and that will change direction of pull of tensor velar palatini muscle, which is coming from above. It is initially running vertically, and then over here along this pterygoid hambulus it will change its direction and it will turn horizontal, and beyond that, that same tendon is then termed as palatine aponeurosis. Now tip of the pterygoid hambulus will provide attachment to pterygomandibular raphe. This raphe is formed by intermingling of fibers of superior constrictor and buccinator muscle. Now just above to this hambulus, posterior border over here will provide attachment to superior constrictor muscle, buccopharyngeal fascia and pharyngobasilar fascia. Now in upper part, this posterior border will show a triangular depression. See, let me bring it a bit closer. Now this is termed as scaphoid fossa. This will provide principal origin of tensor velar palatini muscle, and then this muscle is running down like this. Now midway along the posterior border it shows a triangular process. This is termed as processus tuberis. See, over here you can appreciate this is processus tuberis. Now posterior border above the processus tuberis is in the form of a notch. Now this notch will lodge medial end of cartilaginous part of auditory tube. Okay, so this is the processus tuberis. Regarding lateral surface, it is related with the tensor velar palatini muscle. Regarding medial surface, it is covered by mucoperiosteum of nasal cavity. So same thing you can appreciate over here. This is the medial surface of medial pterygoid plate, and as you have discussed, it is covered by mucoperiosteum of nasal cavity. Now along the posterior border, as we have discussed, there is processus tuberis, and above to that is a notch which is lodging medial end of cartilaginous part of auditory tube. So somewhere over here, this is the territory of nasopharynx, and somewhere over here we will get pharyngeal opening of auditory tube. So this is regarding features and attachments on the sphenoid. Hope you understood well. Thanks for watching.